About to start, thank you for my seats and welcome. Welcome to this lecture with Dr. Mordechai Kedar. The lecture is Israel in a Changing Middle East, Challenges and Opportunities. Dr. Kedar is the director of the Center for the Study of Middle East and Islam and the research associate of the Begin Sadat Center for Strategic Studies. Dr. Kedar served in the IDF military intelligence for 25 years, specializing in Arab political discourse, Arab mass media, Islamic groups, and the Syrian domestic arena. Because of his expertise, he was asked to remain in the IDF for a few more years to assist Israel. He is one of Israel's leading figures in understanding the Arab world and a frequent guest in the Israeli, Arab, and international media. Dr. Kedar lectures about the Middle East, Israel's existence within the Middle Eastern environment, the struggle over Jerusalem, anti-Semitism in the Islamic world and Iran. In January of 2011, Dr. Kedar gave a very insightful presentation on Capitol Hill on why is the Middle East such a difficult area for Americans and Westerners to understand. His famous interview on Al Jazeera about the right of Jews to build in Jerusalem has had more than 500,000 views on YouTube. Dr. Mordechai Kedar's lecture is sponsored tonight by the IPA, the Israel Public Action Committee of Congregation Bat Mishalom, and co-sponsored by the Center for Terrorism Law at St. Mary's University School of Law. The Center Director, Professor Jeff Adicott, who is here tonight, will be signing copies of his new book, Radical Islam Why, Confronting Jihad at Home and Abroad. And also, I do want to welcome, we have some guests we should take mention of. Dr. also, Daniel Akbari, who is a author on Islam, and also Act for America Director Chairman Roy White, and Rabbis Stoll and Rabbis Maris, and Judy Lakritz, who is CRC Director, and Teresa Weaver, who, pardon me? And Rabbi Blockin, and also welcome, as well as Chabad, and we have Teresa Weaver, who's Assistant Director, Executive Director to Diana Hagee. Long introduction. Just in this, say this week's Pasha, this week's Torah portion, Moses is told, be specific. Kosomar, Eile Hadvarim. You have to be specific when you talk, when you communicate. Dr. Kedar is very specific. When he speaks, when he lectures, you will hear not what someone said sometime. He is a scholar of great repute. And so you're going to enjoy real scholarship tonight on a subject that has been muddled, the Middle East muddled, and that is, we are very proud to be able to present Dr. Kedar tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Ari Scheinberg, Lord Osson, Rabbi Avraham Scheinberg, who's helped with the technology, and Bobby and Dr. Leon Gittis, who are behind this event. Professor Jeff Ellicott was the co-sponsor, and all the others who took part in promoting and having this evening. And I believe I have to also thank the radio for airing today the fact that we are gathering here, which I believe one of the reasons for the nice turnout.
Ladies and gentlemen,
is our children. They are pretty because of my wife. As you all know. When we talk about the Middle East, this is usually the map which we, the what? On the time, doesn't like blue. When we talk about the Middle East, this is usually the map which we visualize in front of our eyes. This is, by the way, the Atlantic Ocean, and like more or less 2 meters to the left is America. Another 2 meters is Texas. Yeah. So this is more or less where we are. We look at the map as states like Europe, because this is how we were educated to think that where there is a state, there is a people, borders, government, more or less like us. Because we in the West, and I include Israel as well, we grow up usually in a society like American, which teaches us how to think, how to understand what is around us, and the cultural toolbox which every one of us carries to understand the world, what values are in the world, what is important, what is not, scale of priorities, all these tools, cultural tools, that's what we have. And these tools actually help us to understand the society in which we live, and to know our status, what we should do, what is allowed, what is forbidden, what we should dress, how we should talk, what side of the road we should drive, how we should drive. All these things which are actually the culture which we live in. And in some cases, we think that the same toolbox which we operate by is the same toolbox which all the world uses in order to behave. The same scale of priorities, everyone wants the same thing, the same scale of values, or set of values, what is important, what is allowed, what is forbidden, what is moral, what is immoral, what is desired, what is not. We tend to think that everyone in the world thinks the same, wants the same, evaluates everything the same. And sometimes when we see people behave in a way which we don't understand, the standard question is, what's wrong with these people? This usually, in American English, when people do not understand something or how people behave, they immediately say, what's wrong with you? Or what's wrong with these people? Assuming that if somebody behaves in a different way than us, something is wrong with him. Means we are okay, we are right, and whoever behaves in a different way is wrong. This is more or less the mindset behind this question. because if you understand somebody, when we think that he is wrong, it means that we think that we are right. And he is wrong because he is behaving in a different way. Means we don't accept the fact that maybe he operates according to a different toolbox, which allows things which we forbid, which see in a positive way things which we see as negative, and vice versa. We cannot fathom this because we do not live where he lives, we do not understand his culture, we didn't study his culture, we didn't study his language, that's why we cannot understand his culture. And we live in a lala land. We live in a lala land because we don't understand other cultures. It happens to Israelis. I think it happens also to Americans, to Europeans, to many other Westerners who cannot fathom that there are people and peoples in the world which behave according to totally different set of laws, set of mores, set of values, and set of mindsets. The Middle East is one of these areas where the mindset is totally different, when the rules are totally different, when the way to evaluate the Middle East by Western criteria is blocked, non-existent. You cannot do it. Just like you cannot fix your Chevrolet in a garage of BMW. I have nothing against BMW, believe me. Except that it was produced in Germany, never mind. But my mother never took a cab produced by Mercedes, BMW, only. But never mind. What I'm saying is that everybody understands that the toolbox of a garage which takes care of Chevrolet is different from the toolbox which is used in BMW. The culture, the spare parts, the training of their personnel is totally different. So this is, people understand this. This is okay. But when it comes to fix their culture with our garage, people start to argue as if our garage can fix other cars which are made in different places. Okay? This is more or less just a little equation to something which people understand. And when it comes to cultures, people fail usually to understand. With this preamble, let's talk now about the Middle East. These days, I celebrate 50 years since I started my rendezvous with the Middle East. I grew up in Israel, I was born in Israel, to a family which is actually a European family. My parents came from Poland. And I have all the reasons why to look at the Middle East with the eyes of somebody who doesn't understand anything. But I had a very good teacher in high school for Arabic. He was very attractive and he succeeded to magnetize a group of 13 kids in my age, my class, and we joined this major, we majored in Arabic, and those days, 50 years ago, there was no cell phones and TV in every home, so we had time to learn.
Yes.
And we actually learned Arabic in the lessons of Arabic, we learned Arabic in the lessons of English, this is why my English is mediocre. This is why and we learned Arabic in the lessons of history and geography, and we learned Arabic in the bus to the school and from the on the bus from the school, and we actually put the Arabic books under the pillow at night. Maybe something will come to osmosis to our minds. And when we finished high school, we knew Arabic and we read the Quran, we read the Hadith, the oral tradition. We read classic literature and modern literature and the articles of Muhammad Hassanein Haikal, the mouthpiece of Gamal Abdel Nasser those days. And we read all kinds of philosophers and Jewish writings which were written in Arabic, and I wish that my students who finished BA in university will know Arabic at the level which I knew Arabic when I finished the high school. So this is the background, and when we finished the high school, all the 13 boys were taken en bloc to the intelligence. I spent there 25 years in military intelligence. Although it sounds like oxymoron, military intelligence, we tried to be intelligent as well. After I got released in 1995, I joined the academia, and I'm in Bar Ilan for 20 years already. So altogether, 50 years since I started learning Arabic, and this is actually Arabic gave me and my colleagues the key to open the door to enchanted world named the Arab world, to understand totally different culture, different from our culture in Israel, which is more or less the culture here in this country, made of, because we also are refugees, more or less like the immigrants who came to this country. And yes, and we constituted a nation which is built on an idea. Here it's on the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In Israel is the Jewish idea of being a nation. So more or less the similarities between Israel and the States. So we have the same problem by looking at the Arab world, which is totally different. What do I mean the Arab world? When we look at this map, we see states, but something which jumps to the eye immediately is the fact that there are many borders which were marked on the map with rulers. You see this border between Algeria and Mali, you see between Nigeria and Niger, between Egypt and Libya, Egypt and Sudan, between Iraq and Saudi Arabia. All these borders were marked by rulers. What does it mean? That somebody sat in the cellar of the Ministry of Colonies in Britain, or in London, or in Paris, took a map, took a ruler, drew a line, and this is the state. Maybe with this straight line, maybe you cut a group which lives in the desert as a group. It could be less. Or maybe you merge together groups which traditionally do not live in peace with each other. Let them kill each other, who cares? Okay, this is more or less how the colonialism, the British and the French, related to the Middle East, because all these borders actually reflect the interests of the colonialists much more than they reflect the interests of the local people in these countries. And the names of the states also were given usually by the foreigners. So these states actually are products of the colonialism, not a product of the local people in most cases. These countries were built in an area which I would say the right picture of this area looks totally different. This is the right map, the correct map of the Middle East. A giant desert which needs 3 hours with a jumbo to cross it to the width, in the width. And if you go to the length of the desert, it's like 7 hours with a jumbo. It's wider than the United States of America. This is the biggest desert in the world, the Sahara Desert, which is also in Egypt and goes all the way up to Saudi Arabia, because the Red Sea here doesn't make any climate changes on its shores. The desert hit the water and continues after the water, desert. There is no strips of agriculture in this place. So is the Persian Gulf, also doesn't make any changes to the climate of the environment. By the way, the Persian Gulf is very hot. It's something like 50 degrees, or almost 50 degrees centigrade in the summer. It means that you have to be very careful if you swim in this water, because you might become cooked. In any way or another. So, This is better, you think? So this is the Sahabism, and you don't see borders in the desert because there are no chains of mountains or rivers or things like this. The only rivers which you have here is the Nile and its delta. You have the Euphrates here and the Tigris here, the Wat, the Hidekel, and you have the coastal area of Israel from Ashkelon to the north through Lebanon, Syria, and here in Algeria. But 97% of the space is dry, arid desert. And in the desert, you must live near a source of water. Otherwise, you are dead. Because you have to drink. It's hot weather. And if you find a spring, or you dig a well, or a ditch, you have to defend it. Because there are others in the desert who also need the water, because they are also thirsty. And this is why defending your source of water is the main task of your group. Otherwise, you are dead people. And the most powerful group, the most consolidated group, is the father and his sons. And after a generation, it's the cousins. And after another generation, it's the second cousins, and third cousins, and fourth cousins. Okay? What do we get? A tribe, or a clan, or extended family. The name doesn't mean much. I'm talking about the phenomenon. When everybody is related, and everybody is actually an extended family. And these families have rules. First of all, marrying the daughters within the tribe. You never give the daughter to another tribe, because in another tribe, she will be abused, because she is, as they say in Arabic, nicht kan unseres, not from us. It's in Yiddish. Okay? You won't give your daughter to somebody else when you don't see her, and you can make sure that she is treated nicely. So the immediate marriage, or usually marriage between my daughter and my brother's son, means her first cousin. Because this is whenever he beats her, she comes to me, and I go to my brother and I say, hey, talk to your son. Okay? So this is why I maintain good life. So, but the price is tremendous when it comes to genetic problems, which are perpetuated when people get married within the clan. But as they say, kullu min Allah, everything comes from Allah, not because of our marriage or the patterns of our marriage. It's a recommendation to a student of mine. I have nothing to hide. So this is one very important rule. But the tribe works according to rules, very, very strict rules, and everybody must obey the rules of the tribe. The tribe has a leadership, a real leadership, which takes care of the tribe. Not rulers, but leaders. And usually, it is a traditional leadership, the same family. Of course, if the son deserves to be a leader, so he will be the leader. If not, not. In the tribes has laws. For example, if your cousin, let's say, killed somebody in a road accident, and he runs away, and he comes to you to hide him, you will hide him. In spite of the fact that, according to the state law, it is forbidden, because if you hide somebody who killed somebody in a road accident, you are a partner in crime. Okay? You shouldn't do it. But who cares about the state? The state is there, and the tribe is here. So, and the tribe is much more important for the people. Another bad example is what happens if you're, let's say, 24-year-old daughter, allows herself too much with boys. According to the state law, she is a grown-up. She can do whatever she likes or do whatever she likes. Because she passed the age of 18. But according to the tribe, if she behaves in too free way, she brings shame on the family. What will be her punishment? To be slaughtered. As they say, Ras Lil'ar means washing the shame with her blood, which will come out from her vein when she will be slaughtered. Okay? Who cares about the state law, which grants the young lady freedom? They have their laws, okay? So this is what I mean by tribal laws versus state law. And the tribes is one valley and the state is another valley. The tribe has its own territory, and the most important, the tribe has a fighting militia armed to its teeth in order to take care of their interests. And whoever tries to challenge their interests by invading their vicinity, invading their space, or jeopardizing their interest, first of all, they will shoot you. Then they will start to ask who you were and what you wanted. Because this is because the other is the enemy. Every other is an enemy because he wants to come to take our water. Actually, if you want, it is this kind of culture is described in a way in the book of Genesis already, because it started this kind of culture in the desert, started way before Islam came to the world. In the book of Genesis, Yitzhak blesses his son Esav by Al Harbecha Tichyeh, means you will live on your sword. Means without your sword, you cannot live in this area because you will be chased out. And the struggle over water is also echoed in the book of Genesis with the wells which Yitzhak dug, and the Philistines kept chasing him out from the wells which he dug not far from them. So the culture of the desert is well echoed in the book of Genesis. So reading it through this lens might give some kinds of insights to the book of Genesis, or to the culture where the book of Genesis reflects. So this is, I would say, a necessity. It's not a luxury to live in a tribe. It's a necessity, and it's vital. Otherwise, you cannot survive in such an environment. And it has also its appearance on the map. This is the map of Iraq, the real map of Iraq, or I would even say the only significant map on Iraq, of Iraq, because all this mosaic of parts are actually the tribes of Iraq, divided as they are. They are all more or less in the eastern half of the country, because the line of the Euphrates is this, coming from Syria, actually coming from Turkey, through Syria, into Iraq, it goes down here, and the Tigris, the Hideke, Dijla in Arabic, comes down to the east from the Euphrates. They unite more or less in this point, and they go down to the Persian Gulf, under the name Shatt al-Arab. Between those two rivers, there are Iraq. And this is what gave the country the name. Iraq in Arabic means veins. Like in Arab, in Hebrew, Orek, which is a vein. Okay? So in Arabic is the same word. As you know, Arabic and Hebrew are sister languages. So there are canals. These are the Iraq, the veins, canals which combine the two rivers or connect the two rivers. So you can live either near the river or near the canal because you have a constant supply of water, because Iraq is a very, very hot desert with very, very scarce rains, and you cannot count on rains because they usually there are no rains. And not only this, the terrain in some places is so hot in the summer. The American soldiers, when they came to Iraq in 2003, they discovered that in several places, if you take a frying pan and you break into it two eggs and you put it at noon in, on the sand, within 10 minutes you have an omelet. On the sand. And if you leave it for another 10 minutes, the omelet will be burnt. Okay? This is something which we find it very hard to believe. But this is what they made fun out of it. Okay? So this is Iraq. And this way, because the access to the water is so important, they live in constant places and they don't wander in the place. And their areas or the territories are marked by themselves. It's not in the statement, but they know exactly where the border is between us and them, and you don't cross the border. Because if you cross, you're a dead man. Okay, so this is what Iraq is. So this is, the situation in Syria is no different. In Libya is even worse, because in Libya they don't have water. So they wander in the area, and the tribes in Libya are much smaller because there is no water, so there is a limit to how many people can live in a certain space, so they split much more frequently than they split in Iraq. However, this is not the only division which Iraq and other countries suffer from. The northern part of Iraq, mostly this part, are not Arabs, they are Kurds. And the Kurds also are divided into tribes. These are Turkmens here and here and here. These are Persians, and all the rest are Arabs. So Iraq is divided to four ethnic groups, Kurds, Arabs, Turkmens, and Persians, divided to 70-something tribes according to the map. And it's not in the end. It's not the end, because in Iraq they have some 10 religions, only in Iraq. There are Muslims and there are Christians, and there are some Jews who remain there. There are Yazidis, those whose men are slaughtered and the women and girls are sold to slavery. There are Mandaeans and Sabaeans and Shubak and Zoroastrians. And Alawis who ran away from Syria, and some Druze as well. And all the religions which live in the Middle East have representation in Iraq. So this is another axis of division. And the last one is the sectarian one, because the Muslims are divided to Sunnis and Shia and Salafis and Sufis and all kinds of others. The Christians, when they still were in Iraq, they had like 8 denominations. Today, 6 are totally ran away, and the last 2 are running away. And the Mandaeans also are divided to some sects and so forth. So Iraq actually is divided according to 4 axes of division. Ethnic axis, Kurds, Arabs, okay? The tribal axis, as we see on the map, the religious axis, Muslims, Christians, and so forth, and the sectarian axis, Sunnah, Shia, and denominations. Okay, and the British, when they drew the lines around all these groups together, hoped that one day will come and they all we sit around one fire and sing Kumbaya together. Meaning, if they give them one state, one regime, one identity card, one passport, one ministry of health and ministry of communications, and one government and one parliament, they will all abandon their traditional loyalties to the tribe, to the ethnic group, to the religious and the sectarian groups, and they will all become Iraqis, equal to each other, and they will forget and abandon all the traditional affiliations, I would say. It doesn't happen. It didn't happen. It doesn't happen, and in my humble view, it will not happen, because the more time passes, the more people stick to their old traditional belonging or affiliation. The same thing is in Syria, the same thing in Libya, the same thing in Yemen, Jordan, and many other countries which were created in the 20th century. Look, we in Israel should not be surprised. In Israel, we have two major groups, Arabs, which are like 20% of the population, and Jews, who are like 80% of the population. The fact that we have one state and one border and one government and one ministry of whatever you like, did not make the Jews Arabs, did not make the Arabs Jews, and didn't erase the identity of both and created some milkshake which is neither Jewish nor Arab. It didn't happen. 67 years the state exists with one government, one ministry, okay, one everything, and one passport, and one, and then we still have two groups which do not dissolve into each other. Okay? So there is a difference between state tools or state apparati, like government, passport, and so forth, and even flag, and what people feel towards each other. Okay? It doesn't work. Here, people usually don't understand it, this group thinking, because this country was made by immigrants who came from all over the world as individuals. Came from East Asia, came from East Europe, Western Europe, South America, Africa, and they all sent the kids to the same public school. I'm not talking about particularly Jews who said, but definitely there is a melting pot in this country which after a generation, two and three, you cannot define who came from where or whose grandfather came from where, and they get married with each other eventually. And okay, there are some problems for the melting pot. We see it once in a while, once it's in Ferguson, once in other places. But definitely the melting pot worked very nicely, even if not completely. And America is the calm nation. You don't see people killing each other in the streets because that his father came from Russia and the other one, his father came from Venezuela. Okay, so this is the situation today in America. And this way, for Americans, it's very hard to understand what happens in Iraq, that people still stick to the old traditional loyalties because the groups are solid, are determined to keep their identity, and to keep the other away from our territory. I would say this is one genetic problem, genetic disease of these states. I'm talking about Iraq, Syria, and others, because the people actually view the state as illegitimate. Who created this state? With all these groups which we do not like, whoever we are. Okay? And everybody knows it's the British and the French and the Italians in the case of Libya. So the state as a frame is viewed as illegitimate. Another problem of these countries is that the regime which runs these states is also illegitimate. In the Iraqi case, this case, Saddam Hussein, until 2003, he was a Sunni. And the Shia hated him because he's Sunni. And he oppressed them because they didn't like him. Otherwise, he didn't have to be a coercive as he was. Because they didn't want him. They wanted to reject him. He was never elected in a normal way. He was not legitimate. So this was the problem. Saddam Hussein and Ahmad Hassan al-Bakr before him, and all those who were before him, were all rulers. They were not leaders. Rulers means that they coerce the people in order to rule them. In Syria, the situation is even worse. Because in Syria, the regime is in the hands of the Alawis for 50 years at least. What do I mean, the Alawis? The Alawis are a sect which lives in the northwest part of the country, and they are not Muslims. I'll give you a good example why I think so. I took a picture of a sanctuary of the Alawi, of the Alawis, in the village of Rajar, which is in Israel, to the north from Dan and Daphna, who knows where they are, near the Hermon Mountain. This is a place which they do not allow to photo, and they know why. So I waited with much patience until I heard that there is a heavy rain in that area. I took my camera, and you can see here the water on the floor. And the guard, who usually doesn't allow people to take pictures, was at home because a guard doesn't like to be in the rain. But I got wet, but I got the photos as well. So what do we see here? I can elaborate on this thing for hours, but although they don't reveal what it means, however, when you see very clearly this column topped by two pigeons. The upper one resembles Ali bin Abi Talib, who in their view is an incarnation of Allah, something which reminds us some Christian creeds, especially in the Eastern communities of Christianity. And the lower one resembles Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. Means Ali, the fourth caliph, is more important because Muhammad was a human being, while Ali was an incarnation of the deity. This is what they believe. And they bow to this statue. Okay? Another element in this sanctuary is, you can see here behind the white gate, there is a vitrine. This is the base, this is one corner, this is another corner made of aluminum, and this is glass, and this is glass. Inside this aquarium or vitrine, there is a statue of Mother Mary, and they revere her as a goddess, and they bow to her as well. So when a Muslim sees this sight and what they do, he gets the goosebumps, because this is a sheer avodat elilim, idol worshipping, shirk in Arabic. They are mushrikun, the lowest people on the scale of humanity, according to Islam, because they are other idols to Allah. Instead of believing that Allah is the only God, they think that there are more gods and goddesses by bowing to these statues. And Hafez Assad, and his son today, Bashar Assad, and Salah Jadid, who was the president, the ruler of Syria between 1966 and 70, are all part of this sect. Okay? And according to Islam, not only they don't have the right to rule because they are a minority, there is a big question if they at all have the right to live being idol worshippers. Because idol worshippers, according to the most basic teachings of Islam, have the choice between converting to Islam or being shot by head. And this is the status, according to the Islamic majority of Syria, of their rulers, people who don't even deserve to live. Who knows about this? Who is aware of it? It means these people have absolutely no legitimacy to rule the country, especially to rule Muslims. Because according to Islam, Islam ya'lu wa la yu'la alayhi, means Islam is supreme and nothing can be above Islam. So how could those idol worshippers tell us what to do and what not to do? This is something which is against the laws of physics. So this is why the regime in Syria since 1966 is totally, absolutely illegitimate in the eyes of the Muslim majority of the state. Of course, they were forced to accept them, so they accepted them in a way or another. they tried to rebel between 1976 and 1982, were crushed by Father Assad, means Hafez Assad, and now, in the second attempt to get rid of the regime, they are already 300,000 people killed. And people don't understand it, that these people have absolutely no legitimacy, and I have the proof. I dedicated my PhD to the press of the Syrians, and I found very quickly that all they try to do with their press is to create legitimacy to a regime which has no legitimacy at all. This is the Archimedic point around which the whole Syrian media, which is state controlled, revolves to create legitimacy to the regime by all kinds of ways, linguistic ways and phraseology and all kinds of ways. You can read it in my book. If you are rich enough, because the publisher redefined highway robbery, he got it for me, the whole book. It's a PDF to print it. And he takes tremendous amount of like $75 for this book, which, never mind. But it's not my, I cannot control this, he's a publisher. But the name of the book is Assad in Search of Legitimacy. Message and rhetoric in the Syrian press under Hafez and Bashar. I analyzed the press, the linguistics of the press, and this is what I found. Assad in Search of Legitimacy. Now, in 2003, in 2011, when the Arab Spring, so-called, started, almost immediately, the regime started to shoot real fire into demonstrations, because it's not allowed to demonstrate in Syria. Like 2 months later, in May, the death toll arrived something like 1,000 people. So the then Secretary of State here, Hillary Clinton, declared that Assad is losing his legitimacy. How can one lose something which he never had? But she doesn't understand it. She thinks that if he has a title, president, on near his door, so he's the president, just like the president of the United States of America. She doesn't understand that the president here is a legitimate man who legitimately is the president of this country, at least for 4 years or maybe 4 years again, if he's being elected, and he's a legitimate, no, the only legitimate president of this country. Okay. Whether people like him or not, as a president, he's legitimate. In the Middle East, she can't understand that somebody can be called a president, he's totally illegitimate. So he's losing his legitimacy. Apparently, she didn't read my book. Maybe because it's too expensive for the Clinton Foundation. However, when you move to country, from country to country, once in a while, it's nice. I try to identify the music. Schumann? Liszt? Chopin? Okay. Please, turn your phones off. So if we go from state to state, in these modern states which were created by the colonialism, we find more or less the same picture. Of course, there are some who are viewed by larger chunk of the population as legitimate because they benefit from the regime, but basically this is the same thing, because until a few years ago, no Arab ruler was elected in a normal way, which we know. By the way, Jordan is not so far away from this description. The king, as you know, the ruling family in Jordan are not Jordanian. They were chased out from Saudi Arabia in the 20s, and the British gave them a job to be the ruler, the king of Jordan. By the way, at that time, when Abdullah, the great-grandfather of the current king, his brother Faisal was given Damascus, means to be the king of Syria. But the French didn't like him, they chased him out, so the British gave him a job in Iraq. So he became the king of Iraq. Okay? Who cares? They could care less about what... He doesn't speak in the language of the people. Because he speaks in Saudi Arabic, while in Syria it's totally different Arabic, and Iraq definitely different Arabic. But who cares? They gave him the money, they gave him the soldiers, they gave him the weapons and the ammunition, and we'll go be a king. Okay, so people definitely viewed him as illegitimate in Iraq, in Syria, of course, and the ruling family until today in Jordan is viewed as illegitimate, especially by the Palestinians. The Bedouins could more or less accept them in a way because they are not far so much by the culture, but the Palestinians definitely are different culture because for the Palestinians in Jordan, a Bedouin is some kind of a bad word. Because a Bedouin is viewed as backwarded, somebody who remained in the desert, or here you would say in the caves or on the trees or something like this. But this is the Middle East, how people who live in cities and villages look at the Bedouins. So they definitely don't accept him. And so what did he do? He married a Palestinian woman in order to show them, hey, we are together. This is how usually the world views it. But Palestinians don't see it in the same way. They have a joke that he married her in order to do to her at night what he is doing to us during the day. Okay? So, everything is in the eye of the eyes of the beholder. So, this is, by the way, jokes are very, very important plug-in to understand the culture. And again, you need the language, because without the language, you cannot understand a joke of a different culture. So, another reason why we should take Arabic as a major, you know, before we start shaping the Middle East. However, this is, I would say, the two major problems or genetic problems of the modern states of the Middle East, that the state is illegitimate in the eyes of most of its citizens, and the regime is illegitimate, again, in the eyes of those who do not belong to the tribe or group or sect of the regime. So I would say that what happens today in the Arab Spring, the vastly changing Middle East, was a writing which was on the wall. It was only a question of time when this scheme of creating states, illegitimate states, will collapse. It was not something serious, and apparently this is what happens. However, the Middle East is not only states like these. There is a group of good states, stable states, normal states, legitimate states, which people tend to forget. And I'm talking about mainly the Arab Gulf Emirates. Talking about Kuwait, here, Qatar, and the seven Emirates which are united in the United Arab Emirates, UAE. Altogether, nine states. Just a little comment, the United Arab Emirates are united not like Texas, Oklahoma, New York, and New Jersey, but like France, Germany, Holland, and Belgium. Okay? Sovereign, independent, and separate from each other. In Europe, they united the currency and some other little things. But the states remain states. Germany is a state, independent from France, which is dependent, okay? They did not dissolve to each other and they didn't give up on their sovereignty. Texas is not sovereign. Texas has no army, I hope. Okay, the sovereign here is the Union. Okay? In the Gulf, it's more like the European kind of United States, because they also remained Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Ras Al Khaimah, Sharqa, Umm Ajman, okay, all these remained separate, sovereign, and independent from each other. They united not the currency, they united the army, which is more or less a coastal guard, and the foreign policy. They have one Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and they have one embassy in Washington, D.C., and the United States of America has one embassy for all the seven. Okay, because there is one Ministry of Foreign Affairs, okay? So this is the only thing which they united. They didn't unite the currency and many other things. So altogether we have seven states in the Emirates, in addition to Qatar and to Kuwait. These countries are stable, are nice, are legitimate, and rich. Why? Some would say because of the oil. Right? Wrong. If it was the oil, Iraq would be a heaven. But Iraq is a hell. Libya would be even above the heaven, because Libya has more oil than Iraq. But Libya is at the core of hell. The same is Yemen, which is an oil-producing country, definitely a hell. And Sudan, okay? So evidently, and Dubai, which is part one of the seven Emirates, has no oil and no gas. Maybe 1%, not even 1% of its GDP is made by oil and gas. So, evidently it's not the oil which makes the good life in the Gulf. So what makes the good life in the Gulf? The fact that every single one of these Emirates is one single tribe. Homogeneous society. Not a conglomerate of tribes, ethnic groups, religious and sectarian. One single tribe. I'm not talking about the business people who live there, who come from America or Britain. Or I'm not talking about foreign workers who come for 2 years or 3 years to work in construction. I'm talking about the citizens. Okay? And they are either one single tribe or one big tribe, which is the vast majority of the people. And there are also some Nuchschleppers who do not have any aspirations. So when the soil is homogeneous, it is stable. The state or the political arena is legitimate because they are always the families which ruled, led the tribe 200 years ago when they were riding camels in the desert. Okay, today they are riding golden Lamborghinis. There is no difference because the camel is 4-on-4 and the Lamborghini is 4-on-4. What's the difference? What is speed? Okay, so essentially there is no difference, only the speed. So this is the thing. And they don't have elections. Why? They don't need elections. They have leaders, real leaders, who care for the people, not politicians who come in order to do something to their own bank account or something, and they go away after 4 or 8 years. Okay? And you know, we live in democracy. What is democracy? Democracy is a place where people have the right to vote to a group which eventually will fail to run the state. So they will vote to another group, which also eventually will fail to run the state, and they will kick her out, kick this group out, in order to vote for another group, which, so, what is democracy? A place where people are voting for the people who will fail in running their state. Okay? So, but they, but look, I'm talking about history, look at this. So, no, it's not this. But these Emirates, they don't need elections because they are not alternative elites. Like here, the Democrats, and the alternative is the Republicans. Okay? Here you have alternative group. Here they don't have alternative group because the same families. And they lead the place with responsibility because all the rest are their cousins. They cannot allow themselves to fail in running such a state. They are serious. Unlike democracies where people are being elected, you never know what for. Okay? So this is what happens in these countries. And this is why the ruling, not the ruling, the leading family is legitimate. Because they are unseres. They are from us. Okay? This kind of regime fits the culture of the Middle East way much better than democracy, which is tailored for the measurements of these countries, these societies. Remember the Chevrolet and the BMW? Here we are. Means, if you create a state which is socially homogeneous, it will be politically stable, and on this you can build skyscrapers with helicopter pads on them, so the tenants, when they want to go to the airport to take the private jet, to go to the French Riviera, they don't have to stand in red light too many times. They go, they take the helicopter. Okay? Definitely. And they can take advantage of the oil, if they have oil. They don't necessarily have to need oil. Dubai has no oil. While in Iraq, where the society is fragmented according to tribal lines, ethnic lines, religious lines, and sectarian lines, and everybody fight each other constantly in the streets, the political arena cannot function because the politicians who represent everyone, another group, are fist fighting in the corridors of the parliament when their people are fighting in the streets. And it's in Libya, they shoot each other in the parliament, okay? Although they are politicians. So the political arena cannot function. This is why, by the way, Libya has already, today, has two governments. One government in Tripoli, another government in Benghazi, and then maybe this is the beginning of the division of the state, to two states at least, if not more. So the government cannot function, and this is why the economy in these countries is in a constant collapse. Who with the right mind will invest the second penny after the first penny got burnt in one of the terrorist attacks which they attack each other? Okay, so in spite of the oil, Iraq and Libya and Yemen and Sudan are hell. Without any oil, Dubai is a heaven. Okay, because what makes the difference is not the oil, it's the society. Here in Dubai, it's consolidated, united, homogeneous, while in Iraq, it's fragmented and in constant feuds, struggles, and wars. And this is actually, I would say, an introductory to the Middle East. Now, everything is history, stories. What happened here, what happened there, who said to whom what, who created. Okay, now come the books of history. This is the philosophy, I would say, or historiosophy of the modern Middle East. Egypt, some kind of exception, Lebanon, some kind of exception. Okay, but I'm talking about the paradigms or the big chunks of states in the Middle East. What happens since the last 5 years, since the Arab Spring, so-called, erupted in the end of 2010, all these dysfunctional states actually collapse. Syria does not exist anymore. To talk today about Syria, and unfortunately there are some people who still talking about Syria, is just like to continue speaking about the Soviet Union 25 years after it was divided, fell apart to 10 states. Russia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, okay? Ukraine, Belarus, Estonia, okay, all these states are flourishing already for 25 years. whoever continues to speak about the Soviet Union as if he fell asleep 25 years ago and never woke up since. Okay? The same thing with Yugoslavia. Once was a state, went through a bloodbath in the 90s, and today they're flourishing six republics. Croatia, Serbia, Montenegro, okay? Kosovo, and all these nice republics, and they are peaceful, flourishing ethnic countries, homogeneous countries. Czechoslovakia once was a state for two nations, and they divided it in a normal way, not in a bloodbath, and they agreed where the line will cross and the country, and now you have one state to the Slovak tribe and another state for the Czech tribe, and everybody is satisfied because he has homogeneous state for himself, doesn't have to mess with us. Okay? So this is, even in Europe, ethnicity is still alive. You know what? Catalonia in Spain always is in the edge of getting out from Spain, and I don't know if Scotland will forever be part of the United Kingdom. Tell me, united with the Irish and the Welsh. Recently I met with a Welsh parliament member. He gave me his business card. One side it's in English and the other side it's totally incomprehensible language, although it's in English letters. It's Welsh. Something totally different. And they're not loyal to their identity as Welsh. And he's a parliament member in the British parliament of the United Kingdom, okay? So, tell me united. It's not united. It's only a cover about, and the resentment and the hatred between the Scots and the English. Forget about it. Okay, so ethnicity in Europe is still alive. It's still alive, and it's part of the problems of the United European Union, is the fact that ethnicity did not die with the European Union. So, what do you expect? That the Kurds and the Arabs will be more cozy with each other in Iraq than the Czechs and the Slovaks in Europe? Definitely illogic. Now look at Afghanistan, another atrocity. Forgive me, this is a Hebrew, but the different cultures, the different colors, are different ethnic groups who live in Afghanistan. There are Kyrgyzis and Turkmenis and Nuristanis, Pamiris, Pashtunis, Tajikis, Hazaris, Uzbekis, Aymakis, Baluchis, and it's not the end of the list. Okay? Just like go make a state of Japanese and Hungarians together. Why the heck? Okay? Give the Japanese their state and give the Hungarians their own state. Why merging them together? It's the same thing with the Kyrgyz and Turkmenis. Some of them are speaking Persian languages, some of them are speaking Turkish languages. Some are speaking languages nobody understands, so and they don't even, unlike India, which was also governed by the British, at least in India they know English. So English is actually the lingua franca in India. India is run in English, although English is not the original language of all the Indians, but it's the only language which they can all speak it, the elite, not the people in the street. Here they don't even have English, so they cannot even correspond with each other, they cannot speak to each other, so that's why they shoot each other constantly. And this is the history of Afghanistan. And now try to resuscitate this dead body politic. And unfortunately America is still doing it, for who knows how many years, since 2001. What are we, 16, 15 years? What was achieved in these 15 years? Nothing. Because the one step was not taken to divide this state, just like what happened to the Soviet Union, just like what happened to Yugoslavia, just like what happened to Czechoslovakia. Okay? Divide them to homogeneous states. At least everyone will take care of his own business and leave the others alone. Okay? And this is Afghanistan. Because of the Western presence, it doesn't happen. In the other parts of the Middle East, means in Syria, it happens, and in Iraq as well. Because in these countries, and this is the changing Middle East, already in Iraq, we see here, independent, factually independent, Kurdish district. And the Kurds are independent since 1991, when the United Nations forced this no-flight zone on the Iraqi Air Force above the Kurdish district, although it is Iraqi sovereign country, sovereign land. Yet the United Nations, led by this country, made this no-flight zone on Iraq to save the Kurds after it was revealed that 6,000 of them were killed one day when the Iraqi Air Force attacked the city of Halabja in March, I think, 1988, and killed some 6,000 people in 10 minutes by gas. So in order to prevent this situation again, the United Nations Foreign Security Council enforced this no-flight zone. So the Kurds could build their state because they were not targeted by the regime. Today, ladies and gentlemen, whoever has some dollars which he tries to invest somewhere, invest them in the city of Erbil, which is the capital of the Kurdish district. This city today has the biggest number of cranes per capita in the whole world, I think. Definitely in the Middle East. Now, cranes means investment, construction, hope, and future. Why? Because it's a stable place. From every factual point of view, they are independent. They didn't declare independence because they don't want to aggravate the Turks and the Americans and many others. But from factual point of view, the Iraqi government has nothing to tell them. And if they say, they can talk to the world. It will be, as they say in Arabic, Retzidavad. Okay? You understand Arabic. So this is what, they don't listen to the government, and they don't care about the government, and they have their own government, parties, and whatever they like. So this is already happened in Iran. In Syria, the same thing. To the west, from the Kurdish side of Iraq, we have the Kurdish part of Syria, which is also independent. And the Kurds will never again live under the yoke of the Arabs. And they know why. Because they hate the Arabs, and the Arabs hate them. So this is what happens. The Alawis in Syria, if they want to survive from the knives of the Islamic State, which is the punishment to the world for the creating those illegitimate states, will have to, the Alawis will have their own state. And this is actually what they are doing under the bombs of the Russians today, who are actually creating a state for the Alawis, so they, the Russians, will have in the Mediterranean Sea some two or three harbors. Because otherwise, all the other harbors are frozen during the winter, in the Baltic Sea and, of course, in the Arctic Sea. The only place which they have a harbor in a warm water, which never become frozen during the winter, it is in Syria. So this is why they are fighting so viciously against the rebels in Syria, so they can have access to a sea which is open for the year. So this is what the Russians, the Druze in southern part of Syria, adjacent to Israel, apparently will also have need a state in order to protect themselves from the same jihadists with the knives which already tried to slaughter them. After all, the Druze also are not idolaters, but they are infidels anyway. So this is actually what the Middle East has. Libya is divided to at least two governments today. Sudan was divided 4 years ago officially to two parts. And today we have Sudan and southern Sudan, which continue to fight internally in the north between the government and Darfur, which one day will be independent, and in the south between tribes. Yemen most probably will be re-divided by as it was until 1992 between North and South, South Yemen. And this actually how the Middle East is marching towards the homogeneous units. Slowly, but this is the trend. Not to create more conglomerates, but to divide the dysfunctional states into more viable states, which will be much more homogeneous on the ruins of the frameworks which were thrown by the colonialism some hundred or less years ago. And this is the changing Middle East. This is the trend. Inside this whole thing, we have the Islamic State. And the Islamic State is some kind of a creature which came from under the ruins of both Syria and Iraq, when people who were loyal to Islam, in spite of the fact that both Syria and Iraq were governed by secular socialist Ba'ath parties in both countries. Amazingly, in these two states, now we have the Islamic State. Means the more you oppress Islam, the more the chances that Islam will come from under the ashes or under the oppression to show you what Islam can do in these two states, Syria and Iraq. So the ISIS, what is called the Islamic State, actually is the punishment for establishing dysfunctional states, Iraq and Syria, ruled by rulers, illegitimate as they were, and ideology which pushed the religion all the way out. The religion comes back. Amazingly, this is the place. And the future of the Middle East, in my mind, at least for 10 years from today, will be the Islamic State. And this is the problem, because this is a state, it's not an organization. They have territory, they have ministries, they have rulers, they have local authorities, they have a health system, they have an army, they have police, they have marketplace, they have everything which a state needs, they have. And if the world really wants to get rid of them, it cannot be done from the air. Because you need boots, and many boots, on the ground. Because they hide in the population, you cannot from the air target somebody in the market. Because how can a pilot from who knows how high he flies identify one man or two people in the street? So this is why it needs really invasion of the place of, I don't know who, but maybe the Russians will do the dirty job. If somebody thinks that the Iranians will do the job, apparently he doesn't know the Iranians. Because the Iranians will promise everything, but will do nothing. Like deal, all kinds of deals which they signed with other countries. They promise everything. But for 18 years of negotiations, people understood they do not do anything. And then this is the Iranians, and unfortunately these are some people who still think that they can sign with them something. I would ask, who would buy from the Ayatollahs a used car? After they cheated the whole world for all those many years. Okay, so we feel that there is something fishy in some deals which were made by them, but this is another story. Iran, by the way, will collapse in the future anyway, because Iran is also a conglomerate, which is drawn by the British, a conglomerate of Persians, who are more or less 60% of the population, no more, Azeris, Kurds, Arabs, Turkmens and Baloch. Now the Baloch and the Kurds are Sunnis, and the rest are Shia. Okay, and there is a heavy war constantly between the Baloch and the central government and the Kurds and the central government. Who knows about this? Nobody, because they don't allow journalists to come to this place, only to Israel. And they want to photo a war, they go to Jerusalem, they have breakfast in the King David with fish, all kinds of fish, and they take the camera and they go to photo or to take videotape a war, because they go to 2 kilometers of there, and whenever those boys see the camera, they start throwing rocks, and here's a nice war, and they go back to the hotel to have lunch, and then they fly with them. The war in the Middle East. This way, by the way, people think that the war in the Middle East is always connected to Israel. Well, the world forgets that the whole Middle East is full of wars, which totally are not connected to the state of Israel. So, yeah. Now, Israel now tries to find itself within this mayhem. And this is actually Israel in this changing Middle East. Israel so far succeeded for 67 years to keep itself away. Once we tried to reshape an Arab country, it was in 1982, when we invaded Lebanon, and we came there in order to put a new order, as was said then by Begin, by Sharon, by Rafael Eitan, who was the chief of staff, to create new order in Lebanon. We failed, and we learned our lesson that you cannot fix a Chevrolet by a BMW, okay? You cannot fix Lebanon by Israeli hands. It doesn't work. We work according to different toolbox. We understand things differently. We don't know enough about the societies there in order to correct them or to rectify them according to our criteria. It doesn't work. So, unfortunately, other countries which try to spread democracy in the Middle East don't understand that democracy is a cake which could be digested in this society but cannot be digested there because it creates allergy. Because if you talk to those people about human rights and political freedoms and freedom of speech and freedom of women and freedom of gays and freedom of religion and freedom from religion, which is a cornerstone in these countries, and actually this is democracy. They look at all these freedoms as something which they cannot digest. What do you mean? Freedom of religion? In Islamic societies? Freedom from religion? What will happen to somebody who will announce that he's leaving Islam? He's a murtad. He will be slaughtered. What will happen to a woman who exercises freedom? Excuse me? Rasl al-ar means washing the shame. Okay? So this why democracy as a solution which was tailored for Western societies cannot work in societies which did not go through history and changes of mindset and values as happened in the West, in Europe and in this country as well. This is why the sentence, bringing democracy to the Middle East, I'm so angry whenever I hear it, because whoever says it has no understanding of the problems of the Middle East. You cannot solve problems of the Middle East with solutions which are important from this country or from Europe. You have to use the culture of the Middle East, means tribalism, and to build states according to the givens of the Middle East. Otherwise, all these things will blow up, as they do, in your face. Israel learned the lesson, and we try to keep ourselves away from the problems of the Middle East. We cannot help them. And they are grown-ups. If they kill each other, we don't like it. But one by one, our enemies actually are on the process of demise. Because once Syria was our most dangerous enemy, after we have peace with Egypt and peace with Jordan, Syria remained the most powerful enemy on our borders. Syria today doesn't exist anymore. Now we have Hezbollah and Iran. Okay. So, but Syria definitely is a state which is not any threat to Israel, at least not in the foreseeable future. Iraq is the same. Once Iraq was an enemy, Saddam Hussein didn't like us, was sending against us terrorists, was funding Hamas, and so forth. Recently, Iraq is too much preoccupied with its own problems, and they leave us alone. Libya, under Gaddafi, was also a hub of incitement against Israel. Recently, I don't hear this anymore. Apparently, those tribes are really busy killing each other, and they leave us alone. Sudan, as you might know, the southern part of Sudan has diplomatic relations with Israel. Because those people who are Christians and animists have nothing against Israel. Only when they were governed by the Muslims, they couldn't have relations with Israel. But now as a free state they do have. We do have some shared interest with the Saudis, and there are all kinds of rumors about cooperation or coordination between Israel and Saudi Arabia when it comes to Iran. We see the same eye, the deal with Iran, as some kind of betrayal from the Western parties against Israel and against Saudi Arabia alike. And there are all kinds of rumors about the ability of Israel to fly above Saudi soil if Israel wants, if Israel wants to go to the east from Saudi Arabia, which is Iran. Okay? So the Saudis will not see, and if an Israeli airplane lands in Saudi Arabia in order to refill, they will not ask him to swipe his credit card in the filling station. Okay, so there are all kinds of rumors from this kind. I really don't know if these are correct or not. Yet, the changes in the Middle East change the status of Israel, I think, to a more positive place. Because enemies are, as I said, in the process of demise, and Israel has new alliances, quiet alliances, with some countries like Saudi Arabia, maybe some other Gulf countries, and definitely the threat of Iran changes things in this regard as well. Israel has all the prospects to flourish, to become even more, let's say, bigger in its economy, and more flourishing as it, compared to what it is today. Mainly because we hear less and less threats from our immediate neighbors. Of course, we had the problem with Hezbollah, which still has a stockpile of missiles, a party with missiles. Imagine what will happen if the Democrats here will have a stockpile of missiles, and the Republicans also will start to shoot at each other. Okay, this is liberal culture, okay? Totally different culture. In liberal, it's allowed. Here it's forbidden. Okay? Is this a difference in the toolbox of the Middle East? Okay? Here, little difference. So, this is what we have, and we have to deal with them. Recently I heard that Israeli government sent a message to Hassan Nasrallah that if he tries again to mess with us, it will be the end of him and his community in Lebanon. And Israel will not fight for 33 days. The next war with Lebanon will be much shorter and much more decisive. And this, according to some media, was the message. Whether he took it seriously or not, I have no idea. In my daily conversation with Hassan Nasrallah, he never said anything about this. So, this is, I would say, more or less Israel, which today is part of the OECD, the group of the advanced countries in the world, has achievements in all field which Israel is trying to do. And in spite of our neighbors, and in spite of the neighborhood which we live in, Israel succeeded that, yes, we can. And this is more or less what we Israelis, we are optimistic, and there is a good proof that Israelis are optimistic. The demography of the Jewish population in Israel is on increase, constant increase, unlike demography in Europe and other parts of the world. Jews are making babies, and these are my five. These are my five, and they are pretty, mainly because of my wife. So, and they are, grandchild number 10 is on his way, and Baruch Hashem, we see the future, and we work on the future, and we are confident about the future, and we are optimistic about the future, and this is in my view, especially when we see what happens around us. So, I think that Israel is, in my view, the best place on earth to live. And more or less, most of the Israelis think so, even those who live here. And I know it because they tell me. Many of them live on the Valiskis. Sits on the Valiskis means they sit on the bags, on the suitcases. One day they plan to come and not come back, you know. So this is, in my view, of course, we have some problems here and there, no doubt, like every country in the world. But Israel has all the prospects to thrive and to flourish much more than it is now. Thank you very much. I'll open the floor for questions. Yes, yes, ma'am.
The knife
and the tunnels in Gaza. Very good question. The knife intifada, which we witness every week, today it's one or two cases of stabbings, definitely disturb us. It's not something which we like. We know what it comes, where it comes from. It comes from the Islamic State. The atmosphere which the Islamic State succeeded to spread all over the Middle East with the knives. They slaughter people, so there are others who fall in love with this. And what the Palestinians are doing today is exactly this. They took the knife, and this is a new phenomenon. The knife, which became the master of the scene, definitely an influence of the media, which brings the pictures and the clips, which I can show you, how they slaughter people. You don't want to see these clips, but they watch it very nicely because they like to see, still some of them like to see how we, as Muslims, slaughter the Arabs. Let's do it to the Jews. Yes, sir. Muslim Brotherhood, the godmother of all the terrorist organizations. You know what? People, there are some people who think that the Muslim Brotherhood is a peaceful organization. Let me show you something. You know what logo is? Logo. Logo is not something which is created by a can of paint which somebody spills. Okay? Logo is something which people think about. You know what the meaning of the word logo in Greek? In Greek, logo? Logic. Think. Means what is the idea behind something. Look at the logo of the Muslim Brotherhood. I'll show you so you can understand. Your logo is... is it? Here. This is the logo of the Muslim Brotherhood. This is the sword of the hugs, and this is the sword of the kisses. Right? Here it says, Al-Ikhwan al-Muslimun, means the Muslim Brotherhood. This is the Quran, and this is one word. Who can read it? Wa'iddu. Translation to English?
And against your enemies.
And prepare. Translation to English, and prepare. Prepare what? Breakfast or lunch? This word appears in the Quran only once. Only once. There is a verse which says, and prepare against them, against the infidels, whatever you have from power and bound horses in order to strike terror in to the hearts of your enemies and the enemies of Allah. وَعِدُّ لَهُمَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ كُوَةٍ وَرِبَاتِ الْخَيْلِ لِتُرْهِبُوا بِهَا عَدُوَكُمْ عَدُوَ اللَّهِ. Okay? In order to strike terror. And this word appears in the Quran once. So definitely it sends the reader to this word, okay, in the Quran. So, This is why I'm saying that this organization, by its own testimony, the logo is the godmother or the mother of the all terror organizations. Because the logo actually talks about terror. By this word, wa'idu. and prepared, you can sing in the choir. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, you started out your lecture.
Well, wait, I need my glasses. Yes.
You started out your lecture speaking about water.
Water, yes.
Different water.
Give them water.
Yes.
And it will be nice and peaceful.
And I have really enjoyed your lecture. I've really learned.
Thank you. At least one enjoyed it.
But my question to you, and the opinion that I would like from you, is that in regards to the water, because you've got a lot of land that is desert, do you not think, in your opinion, that you can't drink the oil? You certainly need to drink the water. That this is one form of intimidation and one form of keeping the people in line by limiting the water source, like, for instance, in Afghanistan and in Yemen, they have the water trucks coming, and they're only allowed so much water, okay, per day or per week.
Well,
what is your opinion on
in Yemen?
Yes, Yemen.
Look, I'm not aware of this issue in Yemen, but something very problematic happened in Yemen like 2 years ago. There is a big river in Yemen, and they built a dam. And you know, a dam or a river is a good thing because it keeps the water from running to the sea, and people can use the water either for agriculture reasons or to produce electricity by hydroelectric station, which you can build. It means you can use it in all kinds of ways. But this dam actually collapsed. And today they don't have the ability to collect water, and unfortunately, it is the thing. As you know, Egypt lives on the water which comes from Ethiopia, from Eritrea, from the east, from the east Africa, through the Blue Nile and the White Nile, and White Nile. And Egypt recently has a very big problem. Here it is. These are the two Niles, the Blue Nile and the White Nile, which come from Ethiopia and Sudan and Uganda, okay? So what do the Ethiopians do? Recently they built here a dam. And the quantity of water which will go to Egypt might be reduced by a third. So Egypt needs more water every year for the industry, for infrastructure, for, you know, to drench the people. And if Ethiopia really fills the lake behind the dam, it will cause to Egypt a threat of life, because they see it as an existential threat on the Egyptians. And I really don't know, because the Ethiopians also need the water for development and everything, and it's their water. So definitely there is a war on water until this very day in the Middle East. However, let me give you something about what could be. There was a plan to turn part of Libya, this part, like 100 kilometers or 100 kilometers, altogether 10,000 square kilometers, to a whole range of photoelectric cells. Libya has no clouds, never. So you all constantly you have the sun above these photoelectric cells. And if you produce electricity from such a big area of 10,000 square kilometers, you can send all this electricity to Europe through a big a cable under the Mediterranean to Italy and to the north, to Switzerland, to France, and to other European countries. It would give Europe a very cheap electricity, very clean electricity without any air pollution. Imagine if Europe stops to have air pollution. And will give the Libyans a great opportunity to develop the country. Why? Those photoelectric cells in this plan are not on the ground, but on a height of 3 or 4 meters, means create shade under them. You can distill water with this electricity also in Libya, so you can have under this 100 or 100 kilometers, you can have giant fields which will be in the shade, not in the sun of the desert. And with the water which you can distill, with this electricity, part of the electricity which Libya produces, you could turn Libya into the balm of Europe, if they follow this great idea, giant idea, brilliant idea. Where are the Libyans and where are the ideas? Okay? So this is the problem. You can have definitely great ideas about water and what to do with water, but you need the people to agree to these things. And this is the problem.
There's a famous interview in Al Jazeera.
My interview?
Yeah, would you mind to play so that...
Al Jazeera. Well, Al Jazeera was and still is the main media jihad apparatus which the whole world suffers from. Recently I heard with much happiness that they are closing Al Jazeera in America. Good reason to be happy. However, in Israel they are, for some unknown reason, they are allowed to operate. And June 1st, 2001 and 2008, the Israeli government decided to build some more hundreds of apartments in the eastern part of Jerusalem. After all, Jerusalem is our capital, as we know, since 3,000 years. Al Jazeera didn't like it, and they dedicated a whole, like, quarter of an hour in the main news bulletin to this issue. They brought a footage about Jerusalem from their correspondent in Jerusalem, which created the impression that Israel is actually destroying all the Arab parts of Jerusalem in order to build Jewish neighborhoods, sheer lie. Then come another one, Palestinian, who is in charge of the mapping in the Palestinian Authority, and he continues to spread lies as if Israel expands Jerusalem all over the West Bank. And they wanted another Israeli to abuse him on air because of these things. But because it was too late at night, it was 11 o'clock, the speakers of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs do not like to, you know, to go to the streets in this hour, they want to sleep. So Al Jazeera asked me to come, since I speak Arabic, and to be, I would say, bashed in public because of what Israel is doing. So, you know, sometimes a punching bag punches back. So, bites back. So this was what happened. The broadcaster name is Jamal Rayan. He is the main anchor of Al Jazeera. Was born in Tulkarm, grew up in Jordan, became a leading member of the Muslim Brotherhood, the peace organization. And since, you know, the hugs and the kisses, and since Jordan wants to come out, so he went to Qatar, the country from which Al Jazeera broadcasts,